Hello all, welcome back. We are in week three, and this week we will be talking about recommended practices in early childhood special education. Our objectives for this week include identifying key practices for all tiers of instruction, defining prompts, embedded instruction, adaptations and modifications, and peer support. And finally, applying concepts of prompting, embedding instruction, adaptations, and modifications to your planning. Some key practices include differentiation, which might look like the way we separate our groups or we form our small groups. It might look like who we provide our instruction to and the intensity of our instruction. One of the other key practices that you will see is the zone of proximal development, which is Vygotsky's idea that the actual developmental level of a child as determined by his or her ability to perform a task independently or to complete the task with some guidance from an adult or more competent peer. So being aware of the child's zone of proximal development as the teacher is crucial. The ability and ways of communication, modes of assistance is something we will target as well, and we will take a deep dive into what embedded learning opportunities are, also known as ELOs. Embedded instruction is using a child's everyday routine and activities as a context for teaching skills. The implementation of instruction within the environment surrounding the child and the activities that the child is taking part in is the best way to embed your instruction. For example, if the child is currently sitting at the block center manipulating blocks, the teacher can embed themselves into their play to provide the instruction needed for that child. That may mean also tending to their targeted goals or individual goals without taking them away from their interested activity, and instead providing that developmentally appropriate experience with what they are already using. Again, it is not planning separate instruction time for their targeted skills. Embedded learning is planned and embedded as naturally as possible within an ongoing classroom activity or routine, and the effectiveness of instructional interaction is evaluated and modified if necessary. Again, this is you putting yourself into the child's natural activity that they are currently working at while also providing their targeted goal and targeted instructional opportunity. Embedded learning opportunities, or ELOs, are used when a child shows interest in a classroom activity that is ongoing. When there is a good match between the activity and routine, the child's learning objective can be embedded within that activity or play. So that might include the use of the block center, that might include the use of the art center to provide specific learning objectives within that play. Another topic we will cover are what ABCs are in terms of early childhood special education. We will talk about the antecedent, which is A, the behavior, which is B, and the consequence, which is C. And in the next slide, we will take a look at each element. The ABCs of learning, as seen within a classroom setting, are described as the following. A for antecedent is when occurs prior to the behavior and signals the person to engage in the behavior. B is the behavior, what is happening at that moment, whether that's a tantrum, whether that's hitting, whether that's biting, whether that's whatever that behavior is, B. And then C, consequence, what happens following the behavior and determines if the behavior will occur again. Looking specifically at A, which is antecedent, antecedent occurs in the environment and cues a student to respond. For example, what again, an antecedent is what happened before the behavior. So, for example, the teacher says, everyone line up. That happened, maybe that happened before the child had a tantrum. Maybe the teacher said, Joey, put that down, go sit with the rest of the class. Maybe that happened before the child became upset. Again, this is what happens before the behavior. Environmental events become linked to certain behaviors and consequences over time. Those might be positive or negative, and they create a classroom environment that signals positive behaviors to occur. C for consequence is what happens following a behavior. You tell the student whether to engage in the behavior again or not. Go ahead and pause this video here so you can review. Practice identifying which are antecedents or which are consequences. Next, we'll be talking about instructional prompts. For instructional prompts, that requires assistance. So a teacher behavior that causes the student to know how to do behavior correctly. This will increase the likelihood that the student will perform the task correctly by providing the child assistance. And systematic, which means making a plan and following it each time. And one thing to keep in mind is behaviors have not been learned until prompts are faded. Next, we're going to talk about stimulus prompts. Stimulus prompts are cues that make the target behavior more prominent. For example, in order to encourage someone to push a button, you can make it big and bright colors. If your child is learning the colors, the basic colors, you might put the word red in red, the word yellow in the color yellow, the word green in the color green. Other examples are tracing written words or numbers as seen in the visual, or highlighting relevant text or words, color coding different pieces that go together. These are visual prompts or spatial prompts that might support the child. For a response prompt, this would be an intervention before a response or after an error. Some examples include verbal prompts, modeling prompts, and physical prompts. In verbal prompts, you tell a child how to respond verbally. For a modeling prompt, you physically show the child how to respond, you model. And then lastly, for a physical prompt, you guide the student to make the motor response. So that's a physical prompt, such as using hand over hand as a guide. Here you will see different types of prompts, which include spatial, picture written prompts, verbal prompts, gestural, modal, tactile, partial physical prompts, and full physical prompts. They are in order from least intrusive to more intrusive. Next, we'll be talking about reinforcement. And reinforcement is when a child receives positive feedback after you correctly demonstrate an expected behavior. Reinforcements are not always a reward, a sticker, an edible such as candy or cookies, a pat on the back or a good job, positive praise. These are examples that reinforcements might not always be. Some types of reinforcements include primary reinforcers, which means the biological necessities such as food, water, sleep, and these should only be temporary measures. Secondary reinforcers will be conditioned, so that means they are learned, such as tokens or positive praise, money as an example as well. And then natural reinforcers, which are more effective than artificial reinforcers such as your stickers, your candy, or trinkets or toys. Those are less effective than natural reinforcers. Another topic to talk about is error correction. If a student makes an error, You as an adult or the teacher immediately interrupts the behavior with the most intrusive level of prompting. That might be physically interrupting the behavior, verbally redirecting, gesturing to support, but you are immediately interrupting that behavior and no reinforcement is given. The following are 7 steps to embedded instruction. Number 1, determine the learning objective and criterion. Number 2, gather data to determine the current level of performance for your students. 3, select activities or routines to embed your learning. So this is important to be able to be precise in where you want to embed your learning, your objectives within what activities in your day based on your classroom routine. Number 4, determine instructional interaction. So that might be prompting, reinforcement, error correction plan. Number 5, implement as planned. So follow with your plan. Number 6, record your data in whatever is most appropriate for you. And number 7, check to see if the child has met the criterion. Is the child meeting their goal? Is the child succeeding in what they are working on? Next, we will talk about adaptations and modifications. That means the way you manipulate your environment is how you can adapt and modify for your student. That may be the physical environment. That may be including a calm corner within your classroom. That might be using cushions for whole group time when all the peers are sitting at the carpet. That might be adapting other materials. So having diverse materials, for example, felt books for tactile learners. That might be using different types of Play-Doh that is appropriately stimulating for your diverse learners. Utilizing technology too, that it might include using an augmented and alternative communication system, such as an AAC or a picture, a PEC, so pictures to support your student visuals, and encourage peer support is another way to adapt and modify for your child or your students. Peer modeling is a great support for our diverse learners within the classroom. It allows for the child, your students, your diverse learners to gain skills from their peers as a way, a form of intervention. It benefits our children with disabilities and allows for additional opportunities to use their skills, reinforce their learning, and opportunities to interact and observe their skilled peers. The benefits for peer models are also evident. They practice their known skills, interacting with children with disabilities builds empathy as well within your classroom community. And peers should be trained to be their peer supporter. So whatever child, student you choose to be your supporter, your peer supporter, that child must be trained by you, the teacher, on ways to support their peers that are diverse learners. In the early childhood special education classroom, it's very important to encourage peer interaction. Encouraging children with disabilities to interact with their same age peers is crucial. Pre-planning is important as well. We can ask the children what they're doing with their peers, how they're interacting with their peers. This not only is social emotional learning, but also we're building language within the classroom community. Following up interactions to reinforce positive interactions are also important. And this might include the adults providing prompting or some one-on-one support with the adults on how to interact with their peers as well. Another topic to cover is priming. Priming is exposing our children to activities before that child engages in the activities with their peers. So essentially, you are giving this child or children the opportunity to practice an activity on their own independently with the adult before they engage in that same activity with their peers. So it's target child initiated training. This is important and useful when you're showing your students a new activity. For example, they are going to start a new sport such as karate. They're going to go to a new place for the first time. They're embedded in new social situations. Priming can be useful. And also, if your child is participating in unusual events such as field trips or other special events or special locations that they're going to, priming can really help expose the child to the pre-exposure to the activities would really help the child engage appropriately with their peers after that first exposure with the adult. As we finish up this week, I encourage you to think about the recommended practices we have seen throughout this week and how you can embed some of these practices within your early childhood setting, whether that's your preschool or your daycare setting that you are currently working in, and how we can use some of these practices in our everyday routine. Thank you for learning. See you in the next one.